turn the mic over to Paul Guerin, who will introduce our panel and discussants. So if you could all come up, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Barry. I'll just briefly kick this off with a quick question. How many people were here last year? Show of hands. Wow, only a quarter of the room or so. Okay. So last year I briefly presented on electrifying my home in Wethersfield, Connecticut. And Matt Farrell is from Massachusetts. He built a new home and he didn't have a gas line for me. Comparing and contrasting our projects, and excited. And having someone like Matt Farrell here to kick things off and moderate the panel discussion is an awesome opportunity. And I'll just start with, I met him about 2 years ago filming here in Hotel Marcel when Bruce Becker gave us a walk around tour. Matt's video, over 1 million views. Next year, last summer, he reached out to me, could you film at my house? I'm like, oh yeah, sure. Compare with his house, and that was an interesting contrast. It's the video I wish existed when I was figuring out, can I go all electric in Wethersfield? Will I be fine with heat pumps and water? All those questions. His content for years has kind of handled those topics. So he and I were in Vancouver last week at Electrify Everything, the trade show. 35,000 people attending, test driving 80 electric cars indoors, which was a pretty wild thing to see. Matt was up there leading 8 different times, different discussions, panel discussions, and presenting. So without further ado, Matt Farrell kicking off our panel discussion. I might need to tweak the camera position a little. We are capturing this for YouTube, of course. And let me just back up this pedestal. And this mic will need to be shared between you and Matt. There we go. Okay.
Good morning, or should I say good almost afternoon. Thank you for the introduction, Paul. I produce videos on YouTube about all this kind of sustainable energy, renewable energy products, my net zero energy journey, electric vehicle owner. I talk about all this kind of stuff, and I'm really excited to be joined today for this panel on what we're calling the good, the bad, and the ugly. And if you're familiar with my YouTube channel, I like to end on kind of an optimistic note, so I'd prefer to call this the ugly, the bad, and the good, because I'd like to end on a positive note, because there is going to be a lot of bad stuff we're going to talk about, but there's good stuff too. So I'm joined today by this fantastic panel that has experience doing running at EV charging for HOAs and apartment buildings, condos, developers that are releasing this kind of stuff. So I was hoping that we could kind of go through and do a quick introduction for everybody. Why don't we start down there? Why don't you introduce yourself and who you are and what you do?
Just push a little bit for you, Reed.
My name is Eileen Murkeen. I live in Fairfield County in Westport, Connecticut, in a condo. I'm the maintenance chair, and one of the things that they had to agree to if I was going to do that job was that we would venture into solar and EVs. So, with a lot of help from Barry, letting us know how to handle incentives and so on, we installed 2 level 2 chargers on the property. And when we're going through our conversations letter later, it was just the best thing we could have done.
Hello, I'm Stefan Hartman with Earthlight Technologies. I'm the director of
charging, commercial, charging.
Here we go. Director of EV Charging at Earthlight Technologies. So we do commercial scale solar and EV charging, residential solar, and whatnot. So we have the privilege of threading the needle of all of the different incentives and programs that are out there to make EV charging as digestible as possible for host sites or building owners that might want to deploy it, and then we sell them.
Good morning, my name is Michael Frisby. I'm the founder and owner of Noble Energy Real Estate Holdings and Noble Gas Inc. I build automobile refueling stations. I'm a resident of Somers, Connecticut, our office is in Hartford, so we're a Connecticut family-owned business. We're trying to look to the future of transportation, building automobile refueling stations with larger footprints that will allow for gas, EV charging, hydrogen as it comes along, and kind of transition forward.
Hi, I'm Sharon. Excuse me. I'm Sharon Hunter, and I'm a member of the Brantford Clean Energy Committee, as well as an alternate on the Brantford Planning and Zoning Commission. And I'm going to talk about how we established electric vehicle charging stations in Brantford with a tremendous amount of help from Stefan and Earthlight.
So to kick things off, I was hoping to kind of ask a question that we can kind of go down the road and kind of like talk about your experiences. One of the first questions is, what's been the most significant challenge that you've had in rolling out EV infrastructure and getting charging out there, and how did you overcome it?
Well, I think that my portion of the panel is hopefully going to be the good, because we had relatively little obstacles. I think the hardest thing for us was getting through the incentive process and applying for the incentives and waiting for them to come through and dealing with all of the bureaucratic rigmarole that one needs to in terms of incentives, unless Stefan wants to add, because he was definitely intimately involved. So if he has anything more to add about that, then he would know more than I.
What about you?
Sure, I think the biggest challenge for me is the entitlements for new projects. When I go into these cities and towns, they look at our idea of what the future looks like for automobile refueling is, it's just another gas station, right? In New England here, we have a lot of 30, 40, 50 year old converted service bay facilities that have environmental challenges or other things. And when we try to explain to them what we're thinking about and the ideas about the future of transportation, they can just picture a gas station. I don't want another gas station in town. And what we're trying to do is kind of change their idea that now that we've built a few, now I can bring people there and show them that this is how we design and implement. As an example, we'll have a forecourt for gas, but we also have a forecourt for EV canopy. So we have charging out front, right, as opposed to in the back corner. And one of the things that kind of keeps us, sets us apart from other folks is we're buying 3, 4, 5, 10, 11 acres because you need real estate in order to be able to implement the larger footprint, the programming, because the technology takes space, the infrastructure. You need space to put all this stuff. And the other thing that we're doing with the large footprint is we can look at alternative sources, battery storage, solar, all those other things that a lot of your typical New England style gas station can't implement and put into.
Yeah, for us, it's been the data. We get a lot of phone calls for folks saying, hey, I've got this property at ABC location, and we'd like to know what our options are for putting in an EV charging station. And so we can map and say, are the tax credits, local incentives, what might be available to them? And then when they start asking questions about the use case that they want, well, how many cars are driving by here? That heavy, what is the utilization rate going to be? How much can I charge? And there's only so much data that's out there. So we've been, and there's a kind of a chicken and an egg challenge of, well, are there really that many EVs on the road? Well, we have data as to how many are being registered and how many are being added, but where are they specifically? You gotta dig a bit deeper, and it gets a little heady for somebody who just wants to put some EV chargers in, because in concept it sounds like a good idea. So that's been our thing, is just trying to digest that and make sure that we're not misguiding people without also over-interpreting limited data.
I would say, in Brent, here at Brantford, we really did not have any challenges. I think what might have been a challenge in an HOA would have been where to locate a parking space, because parking is sometimes limited and you have to leave room for handicap spaces, and we basically have plentiful room for parking. And it was, the whole thing went really smoothly, and we want to get people to be able to charge in garages too, but there's almost no need to.
But to build off of that for an HOA, are there other concerns that you have to take into account, like what amperage, what kind of service you have to buildings and things like that?
We, what we did was we went throughout the property and we wanted to locate them near transformers so that there would be less channeling and running electricity. And so it basically they picked themselves because we worked with what the transformers were providing. And ultimately, we're hoping to have more EVs on property now. People can just pull up. They're being respectful. If they're not in an EV, when the sign's up that it's for EV charging only. Like, you can't just park your EV there because you have an EV. We want it for charging. issue yet. We don't have to do a lot about it. We may have to get to signups at some point when there's more EVs, but it's, I would think in an apartment building where there's a lot of assigned spots, it could get more difficult to figure out where to place them.
I can answer that. Okay. I'm also the sustainability chairperson at the condo that I live in, and we have a unique situation in that the condo was developed in phases. So there are some buildings that have garages underneath other units, so they don't have direct access to their electrical panel. While we have other phases that are sort of regular garages that attach to the home, and the electric panels are directly into the person's home. So for those units, there's really not much of a challenge. Just you have to have a licensed electrician and an approved electrical charger and just have it all taken care of. But for the units with the detached garages, we've had to establish a policy, whereas the an electrician has to come in and evaluate your personal grid, your power source, and determine whether to upgrade your outside meter. And then unfortunately, the electrical outlets within the garages are paid for by the association. So you then have to attach that electrical outlet to the personal units panel. So that's been a challenge because there's a lot of different variations. But, and also there's the talk about common area and the unit area. So we've had one test case where a person has had an electrician come in and he's paid for the inside work, the garage and the upgrading of the electrical and the charging. But the trenching that's needed to get from his power source to his garage is will be negotiated with the board to see about how much they will cover and how much the owner will have to pay. So it's in flux, but it is being discussed, which is good news.
So kind of building off that, this might be, do you have something to
add? I can
add
to that. Okay. One of the main reasons we wanted to install the chargers is because they're level two chargers, they're 220. The garages are the associations that are being used by the unit owners, and they're 110. So if they wanted to put a level two charger in the garage, they have to run the 220 out from their house and do the trenching. And the actual numbers, which might be interesting, we had three different electricians look at three different situations, and it ran from $8,000 to $11,000 or $13,000 per unit. And most people just don't want to spend that kind of money. So the fact that we put the two level two chargers in on property for everyone's use is cost efficient, and they do have the ability to drip charge if they want to. They can just plug into the 110, paid for by the association right now, because there's only a limited number. Once there's more, we're gonna have to get that figured out, maybe a monthly charge or something. But it's so expensive to run the 220 out with the trenching, and then they have to repair everything.
So with all the hoops they have to jump through and the costs, what, like, I'm gonna go to you too as well, what's the community interest in doing? As you're trying to roll this out, how many people are asking for this?
A few, and interestingly enough, the few that have asked have plug-in hybrids. So you don't even need to plug in a hybrid, in my opinion, a 220. We have a regular hybrid, but it's dribbling in. We're finally trying to get our documents finished because they'll have to write an application if they want to run the 220, and it hasn't forced us to make these documents come out of the attorney's hands and into RSMB revised, because they're using the level two chargers on property or they're drip charging.
There hasn't been a lot of requests at my particular condo, but it's really the board has been constantly discussing it and trying to determine a more specific policy. But I also want to comment on the reason that we don't have community chargers is we did discuss having the chargers as you had set them up, but you have to register those chargers on a grid, and my particular condo board did not want strangers coming into the community and charging their vehicle because it would appear on a map and anybody could just come in and use those chargers. So that's why we opted not to do outside chargers, but to see if we could establish some kind of policy to get our residents the ability to have chargers in their garages.
Sit down and come down. Maybe can you run it down? Another one down.
Planting from here. So one of the questions I think if I could toss it to Stefan, I've got a question for both you and Michael about this. I'm curious if you could kind of talk about how incentives are playing a role in this, and also as kind of a follow-up to that, is like, what hoops do we have to jump through for these incentives? How difficult is that?
So for Noel, the incentives are key. So we're building the infrastructure on our new industry locations with the idea that we'd like to participate in the NEVI program. So we are, all of our locations have been accepted. Now we're through the second phase of NEVI. We're, you know, I think the deadline's coming up next month, and hopefully that we'll be able to get some support for that. The challenge we have with that is if you do any work prior to that, you don't get reimbursed for it, so you have to wait for it. So we've been working with the state of Connecticut and DOT, but we're 2.5-3 years into the NEVI program where a lot of that money hasn't been deployed, and we have locations that are ready to support these DC fast chargers. So what we've done is we bought level twos to put into our locations, and we provide, right now we provide that as an amenity. So there's no charge, but at the same time, we're excited about getting the next round of funding done, and hopefully we'll be part of that. One thing that I'll mention, we've talked about our challenges, and I just thought of it is, you know, we're an independent gas station convenience store chain, and the reason we're independent is nobody can tell us what to do. One of the challenges I've had is working with the EV charging manufacturers and trying to get the right fit for our locations, because as an EV owner, range anxiety is real. And I used all the different platforms to see which ones were most reliable. A lot of times they weren't. So what we're doing is we're going to be able to actually purchasing the units and making sure that the maintenance and the reliability is where it needs to be, so that customer Noble doesn't look back to one of these other manufacturers and say, oh, you know, Noble's no good because that charger doesn't work. So we want to take that on to ourselves, and I think that's really important.
You're not handing off that to somebody else to take care of.
I just want to make sure I stay on topic. So you're asking about the challenges or the availability of the incentives?
It's kind of the how important are the incentives for doing this, and then if there are any challenges you want to highlight.
Well, it's the spotty availability of the incentives. There are several EV installations that would pencil just fine without an incentive, right? But the fact is that if they're publicized and the carrot is dangled, but we don't know when the money's going to come back out again, any business operator would say, well, I'm not going to do it pay more than I need to if there's going to be the support coming for the project. So sometimes I wish it would just go away, because there would be some work for it. But it would be far better if there was more incentives and it was just routinely available, even if they were more modest, because then it creates a little bit more of a reliable path for us to take, because it could take months for an incentive to be approved. Once it's approved, you got to go through a utility process to get those transformers to figure out exactly what those things are going to be. So Massachusetts, for example, there's a state incentive that first has to get approved, that takes 2 months, then it goes to the utility, then you go to the engineering department to find out what the work order process is gonna be, and you hope that the money's still there. You know, and then you're hoping that that equipment is still available. So the timelines and the money coming and going, it'll level out eventually.
What changes would you recommend to make this easier for people like yourself?
This is going to sound overly simplistic, but there needs to be more money, right? If you have a really small pot of funds, the competitive process to get your slice of that pie becomes very convoluted, very competitive, and it rules a lot of people out who maybe have an interest in doing this, but they don't want to get into a really elaborate venture, that's a big distraction from their core business.
What? Okay. Go ahead, Matt.
I'd like to add to that. I think that there is a pot of money out there that needs to be deployed to shovel-ready projects that are ready to go versus this long-term idea of, hey, we have a corridor and we need to fill that corridor. If there's a shovel-ready project, if the charger's in the ground, people are going to drive and get to those. And a lot of these projects that have been picked may not be shovel-ready. It's just a location that still needs to go through the entitlements and they still need to go through the utility companies. So I think a coordination with utility companies, I've run into it where it'd be a great project, utility companies like, well, you need a 2008 service and we can't support that, so you can't put it there. So let's work together to figure out a solution to make it work, because we have a good location and needs to make it work. There's no coordination. The folks in the field, you can't do that, as opposed to let's figure it out and make it work.
Do you think there's a streamlining that can be done around the applications, asking for the money, the incentives? Do you think there's a streamlining that can happen there? Because you both have mentioned how, like, it's almost like a hurry up and wait. You have to wait months.
I'd say on the level two side in Connecticut, it's pretty streamlined. It's pretty straightforward. It's just spotty in terms of availability. The DCFC is not streamlined. The DCFC, some of you may be familiar with this, some of you aren't, is a point system. You can go through this work developing a project, figuring out what you want to do, you put in, and your points are not high enough to get it, you're kind of dead in the water, try again next year. So again, more money would be more awards and a clear path to success. But so I think DCFC, the streamline, would be more money to make it more routinely available and maybe some kind of dashboard or something to let people know kind of where things are at, like other states have done.
It's kind of a question for all of you. We could start with you on this one if you have something to add to this, but what's the one thing you would change about the current state of the EV charging infrastructure to make it more accessible and efficient?
Well, I think I have to agree with Stefan. You know, if we had more money, that would be really wonderful. And I also think that I'm very lucky to be living in Brantford, because our leadership in town hall has been really very forward thinking in terms of establishing the need for electric vehicle charging stations. So maybe if the administrations of towns could talk to each other and talk about the advantages of having these kinds of things in their town, that might be helpful to some other towns.
I think the thing that would be most beneficial for me as an EV driver, my normal daily routine, is to have chargers that are available in the areas where I need them, right? So as an example, if I'm driving in and off the interstate, that's great if they're there. If I happen to be, you know, driving around town, bringing my kids to whatever event they need to be, I drive a lot of miles, so we need to support that any way we can. So the more chargers we have, yes, I have a home charger, but I also have a few kids now that are starting to learn to drive, right? I'd like to get more EVs, but I only have one home charger. I only can support that. I can't support the everyday lifestyle. So those chargers in critical areas would make more sense for me.
That's one thing that would change it.
I do think that the bar needs to be raised on some of the level two incentives. You're asking if it's streamlined, and I was praising the level two incentive in Connecticut as being pretty streamlined. It's probably too streamlined. And to Michael's point, you know, there'd be a lot of cowboy projects that don't actually go anywhere. So just like any yo-yoing effect on program design, you know, maybe the bar should be raised a little bit, and that would actually create quite a bit of improvement, because there are projects that are near shovel ready. Town of Brantford has more ambitions to deploy more, and we're just waiting on the money to reopen. But those are more real than I know of other projects that are in there. And the utility right now is, they're trying their best. They're coming back and they're surveying us and asking us where our projects are at. And presumably they're doing that with other installers as well to gauge the reality of the situation, but it seems very subjective and manual. So we increase the gears a little bit.
I would say for level two charging, in terms of our condo setup, we're really good. We're the home base. We're making sure people can charge at home. Sometimes they want to be able to go to a level three and just, you know, be in and out. As a as an individual, my concern about my husband and I, if we had two EVs for the two of us, we travel to places where there is just not a good charging network. And I don't want to get stuck. It's not just range anxiety. I want to have to sit there and wait because someone else is charging. So we have our hybrid EV combo, you know, that'll work. So if anyone has an idea of when the network is going to get good in remote areas, I'd love to know that.
I do that if I could. Just add one other one. I'm also a renewable energy developer, and there have been a couple of times when we bring a project to the utility that co-locates solar or storage with the EV charger, and it's actually way harder to do than you think. So, for example, to put in some EV charging stations, we usually put a designated meter on it because the cost of operating it is more manageable that way. But now you have a building meter and an EV meter. If you put in a solar array, when you can't feed necessarily 2 meters in a simple fashion. And that's a whole other can of worms. I can get really heady on that. But I was glad to see that in some of the slides earlier that Chair Gillette had on this meeting. I think Claire Coleman had mentioned it too. There seems to be like some plans to align the co-location of renewable energy, whether it be solar and ESS and EV. So that's very hopeful, and that can make things clear.
So one of the things I would also like to kind of go down the line for is, what advice would you give to somebody who's just kind of starting out and thinking, I want to get EV chargers installed in my condo or my HOA, or I'm thinking of building, you know, I have a business and I want to add them. What piece of advice would you give them if they're just starting out now?
Well, I think one of the wonderful things that happened yesterday was having, you know, this EV showcase where they could come and talk to people who own EVs. They could talk to car dealers. They could go for a test drive. I think that was a wonderful happening, and I would love to see that happen again. I think in terms of just doing some research and talking to as many people as they can who currently own EVs. I think that's the best way for people to start.
My advice to someone is, if you haven't tried an EV, most of the people in this room have, right? It's exciting, it's fun, it's new, I think it's the future of transportation. I think that, you know, to get over that range anxiety, it's important. I think Connecticut could be a leader. We're a relatively small state, right? With the idea that if we had the infrastructure in place, then I think there'd be more vehicles on the road, for sure.
Sorry, I'm asking clarifying questions. Are you asking about advice for EV adoption or EV charging?
Charging.
So if you want to do some EV charging, I think it's really important to understand what is the use case, who are you serving? And who are you serving? Who's this for?
We're down to one.
So I would say, if you're looking to do an EV charging station, it's really important to understand, okay, who's this for? Like any business model, you know, who do you intend to use this for? And then it's so important that you bring in somebody who can discern and thread that needle, because there's equipment costs, and I think a lot of folks focus on that. I get calls from car dealerships all the time saying, hey, I just bought this 50 kW charger. Can you guys come and install it for me? And I'm like, first off, 50 kWs are just, you know, forget it. It's useless. What do you want it to do? So it's going to be very unimpressive if you're trying to sell a BMW, you know. But anyway, that's opinion. But the case in point is that then it's ineligible for incentives. We've got to bring in a whole new service for that. It's going to cost you hundreds of dollars a month for those peak, you know. So there's all these variables that need to be looked at. So I do think that checking with an expert that can look at it from all these different angles and say, what is it that you want it to do? And from a technology agnostic standpoint, let's design an overall structure that takes into account incentives and cost of operation and make sure that it actually has the end result, not the lowest cost of entry, not the simplest, just quick and get it done type of thing. Because you're going to have that infrastructure for 10, 15 plus years or more. Let's get it right.
So I'm not quite sure how to follow that, because that's pretty much what I was going to say. Take a look at your population. What kind of charger are you going to need? Are you charging a
18-wheeler, or are you charging people, you know, automobile? Basically, make sure you have the good technology. It was important to us to use the incentives. The board had no problem approving it because we really netted out quite well, and it's an amenity for our community, and we're encouraging people to have EVs by having chargers there. So we wanted to be able to serve as many as possible.
Before we start opening up to the floor, and you have to tie back to the good, the bad, the ugly, or the ugly, the bad, the good, I was hoping that you, each of you could kind of call out something that's about the bad, but kind of end on a high note. What is your high note to take away that you hope people take away from this?
Well, because I'm representing Brantford and, you know, that municipality, I would like to end on that with the fact that, you know, if you really can get your administration and the people in your town to be forward-thinking and establish municipal chargers in places that people do go. So we have two chargers in Foot Park in Brantford, where there are tennis courts and pickleball courts and playgrounds and walking paths, and so that's a really high utilized area. And then we have some more at the animal shelter, where people, you know, go often for their cats and dogs. So I think that that's a really wonderful thing. You can just try to encourage your municipality to look at those kinds of areas for high usage for EV charging.
Well, I'd like to leave you with the fact that even though it's a challenging process, Noble is all in on electrification of vehicles. We're investing. Some people say it's just the incentives. We're investing our own money into this already, building new industry facilities with the underground already there, ready to go, so that we can plug and play, no pun intended. As soon as we are able to get those chargers in, if the incentives don't come for some reason, we're still progressing forward to put them in. Just to Stefan's point, it makes more sense as a business owner. If somebody's going to incentivize you to do it, you do it. One of the things that we're also doing is we're working on some special projects that can help translate the medium and heavy vehicles over on some of our bigger projects. We'd like to be a pilot for that, so that we can use alternative energy sources to help support that in areas where there's a big demand for large logistics type companies that can transition over. If you incentivize one company and give them everything, the other companies around them wouldn't be able to do that. We're trying to work to be able to support that and then roll that out across the state if necessary.
I would say something to look forward to is that, and not to get too dramatic, but like the long arc of EV adoption, it's going to happen. It's just going to happen. It's just whether or not you're suddenly surprised and in an uncomfortable position because you've invested in yesterday's technology. So, you know, just knowing that it's going to happen and acknowledging that, all right, this is something that we should just consider with every business decision or lifestyle decision that you're going to make. Because of the great work of the EV Club and other organizations in Connecticut, there's a lot of resources out there now. I know I was talking about like spotty data, which is true, but there's a lot more data every year. I've checked in on the EV Club over the last 10 years or so. I don't know how long it's been exactly. But a handful of people getting together at somebody's house to something like this. Folks like that have been blazing the trail and helping make it easier for everybody after. So some of the licks have been taken. Organizations like the Hotel Marcel and the EV Charging and all this, it provides great example case studies for anybody who wants to do it later. You don't have to take the same leap of faith. It's more replicating a model. So you get on it.
I think a lot of EV charging is happening at home base and at work. My friend has an EV charger at her office in Greenwich, and it was so easy for her to make the decision to get an EV because she knew she could just park at work and then move her car during the day. So I'm going to tell a story about something that happened that didn't work in our town. I think the sustainability organization thought it was a good idea initially to put an EV charger at the train station. However, people get on the train, they're in the city all day, and then they come back. They don't have the opportunity to move it. And what you were saying earlier is places like the dog park, and we have one in our library, where municipalities were investing in them, to put them in places where there is some transient parking is a really good idea. And every time you see that car, and it's the same car all the time, parked at that EV charger, it's got a license plate that says on off.
Okay.
But it's great, and you know, it's.
So then I was thinking we could kind of open it up to questions if anybody has a question. I saw you first, so I'm going to call on you first. So.
Okay. Well,
one
microphone.
It's okay.
We'll get it on right. Matt, it's great to see you. I see you all the time on YouTube. Long time follower, subscriber. So I'm Phil Herter, down from Hartford with Megavolt Power. You know, we're wondering where the chargers should be. Obviously, they need to be where we need them, right? Well, how about a precedent of, in the city, the greater London, England, they've got like 50,000 chargers all in the streetlights. The streetlights, you have a cable, you just plug it in. That's all people need to do, and it matches up with your credit card. Why can't we do that here? People really don't even know what's happening around the world. So we can match whatever they're doing there. And then you mentioned, Stefan, you were saying, gosh, you know, if I go from place to place, I would like a charger where I'm heading, you know, at your destination. There's an app called C-ClickFix, and cclickfix.com. It is actually connected to the municipalities. And so, like, for instance, there'd be like a branch overgrowing a stop sign, or you know, a sign upside down or a pothole. You can take a photo of it, you upload cclickfix, and they get it done. You don't actually even have to think about it or write a report or find the right person. So we should do the same for like dropping a pin on the map where you want to charge. Hey, give me a charger here. I see a lot of throughput, and it's just, maybe it just missed over one of the surveys, you know what I mean? And then finally, I want to say, you know, Stefan, you mentioned also again, you know, what if there's a high traffic area and you're interested in installing a charger? Don't you think that DOT has already done a study for a lot of these routes, and they should just have location-based studies available, like a little package they could just give you? Because you want to put one in, they already got the data, why reinvent the wheel?
Yeah, no, that's great. More data is everything. I mean, I haven't seen that kind of granular data yet. If I'm missing it, I'm all ears, because that would be wonderful. We do have some local data, but it's not quite the precise, you know, data that some of our clients are looking for. Because you could have a lot of local people driving EVs, and they might go down this road, but somebody who lives locally is not going to use your DC fast charger. Right? What you need to know is data on the transients, the people who are passing through, and they have a 300-mile day, and they need a place to stop. Where do they start? Where do they end? Right? So it's really about, well, those EVs that are on the road, where are they coming from, where are they going? And we're not tracking registrations on that road either. So there will come a point where there's enough EVs on the road, and there's going to be a healthy mix of everybody, local as well as people who are just weekending, to those who are passing through for the day.
Can we pick up?
Yeah, right.
Sorry, who is it?
Hi, my name is Jenna Bygrass. I am a staff member at Pura that works on the light duty EV charging program. So it was great to hear all of your comments.
A little further away.
A little further. Is that better?
All right,
we got you. But so I just wanted to reiterate that we are very happy to get comments in any form in our dockets, whether it's just showing up to a tech meeting and saying that you want to speak, or providing written comments, or et cetera. We would love to have more and more participation, and would love, you know, thoughts about ways to improve the incentive process, or et cetera. I was wondering if you talked a little bit about the level two incentive process. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that and what kind of like challenges you've experienced. the utilities and getting approval and getting the incentives, equipment, et cetera.
My coworker Parker's here. I'm sure he's going to be saying, oh, make sure I mention this, make sure that, and I'm sure I'm going to mess it up. I'll just reiterate what I said before, that, you know, getting an electric bill and sending in an application and having the money set aside seems a bit too easy, you know. And I worry that if it's great that it's easy for us and our clients, and we don't want to waste our own time, so we develop projects that we think are real, so we don't want to chase, you know, whatever. But we do run into a lot of folks who have money reserved that did it themselves, and I know that they're tying up the queue. And I'm also well aware that just to do good service by a customer, if I can lock in the money before it's gone, I'm going to. You know, and we try to be honest with the utility and have that relationship of transparency. And if a job is no longer real, we tell them, give it to the next person. And hopefully others are being conscientious as well. So right now, just in our sliver of the EV world in Connecticut, we're trying to do the right thing. But if there's ways to gauge or track in a more objective way, I think that would be great. I don't know what that looks like, unfortunately, but I do think it's just an opportunity.
Just want to let you know, we haven't taken advantage of the level two incentives because we're working toward DC fast charge. So with those level twos, we're going to move to the next location. So it wouldn't be fair to
take that
incentive and then not have the level two when we're working toward the DC fast.
There's a lot of questions. He has his hand up first.
So, you know, we're chasing what we think is the growth curve for EVs and trying to catch up to that and modernize it. It all makes sense. But if the solid state battery revolution comes along and we have much longer range, much faster charging times, does that change the dynamic in terms of what we're installing or need to install? Does that obviate the rural dilemma because range anxiety goes away? I'd just be curious if you're forward thinking about that day, because China apparently has already started commercializing for EVs solid state technology. I don't know how soon it will be real here, but it could come very fast.
Anybody have thoughts on that?
So understanding the technology is important for somebody like me in a commercial perspective, because whatever comes along, we want to be the leader in the industry. So again, if you're driving to a Noble station, we have enough land and area to be able to support that, because if you all of a sudden you have a new technology and you still need to be able to, even if you could do it in 5 minutes, you still need space, because you'll have more cars, you need 5, 10, 15 fueling positions, however that means. So I think we're managing that forward. We're future-proofing our locations to be able to allow for that kind of stuff.
I'd add to it that even though that technology is going to be coming, it's going to take longer than you think for it to roll out. Because like even EV chargers, like if it charges in 5 minutes, how fast does that charger have to be? Does the technology exist to even do that yet for a charger? So it's going to take a while for this kind of to roll out. So I think we have time to like let it grow, but yeah. I think you were up.
So I thought Steve here was going to ask about the IRA. He didn't. So, is that an alternative to the incentives? Does that work for some businesses?
Well, it's certainly one of the first things that we look at. You know, there's a eligibility map the IRS makes available, so we can know who's available for the 30C tax incentive. It's one of the first things we screen for. It's wonderful that, and maybe some folks in this room don't realize this, but those tax credits are actually available as an elective pay for nonprofits and municipalities as well. That's a big changer. You know, it's something that Brantford immediately recognized and said, oh, wow, you know, we can get some money back. Condo associations in the past probably had to find somebody to lease the equipment to them, and now they can own it and can still have the initial capital expenditure to deal with. But that stuff is certainly there. We are seeing on the depreciation side, which I don't think the IRA really tackles, it's sunsetting, and some of the bonus depreciations are going away, which is unfortunately counteracting some of those new incentives. But it's wonderful. It is pretty limited though, so a lot of urban areas where maybe you need more level two charging, things like that, those are not eligible for 30C tax incentives in a lot of cases. So we found that the rural areas are getting it, but maybe we need more incentives and support for those urban areas.
My question's for Mike, and first off, just to recognize Noble. What an amazing platform. I worked at Tesla, worked at Apple Green Electric. We put dots on the map, even specific parcels that we wanted, and then a year later, we see Noble building a site. So it's really exciting to see what you're doing. I guess my big question here is, you know, how, what are you building? Like, how big are the charging stations? How many ports, even as an entry point? We see NEVI saying 150 kW, you know, no less than four ports. But that's less than the equivalent of like a Tesla Gen 1. Whereas when we put in Waterbury, we only got eight stalls at 154 per pair, and we should have built 12 Gen 3s with, you know, 250. So, you know, going into this, the first iteration of non-Tesla, but maybe NACS, are we looking at 150 kW? We're looking at only four stalls. Is an EA type site sufficient? You know, to make sure that when you pull in, you know there's going to be a port available, especially if maybe one's broken. Just curious about what kind of scale you're looking at for initial rollouts.
Sure.
There's a lot of missionaries. David Tanner. And he did a lot of the electrification of this little state. And you were talking about non-Tesla, maybe EV brands. Yesterday we demoed Rivian charging from the superchargers out there. So just to be aware, people aren't aware of that already, that blanketing of the state with chargers is happening with the opening up of the existing superchargers to many other brands. So let's take this one.
That's a great question. So we're trying to be forward thinking again, and we want to be able to support the demand that's out there. So we're looking at least four 350 kilowatt chargers, you know, double whipped. So if you pull in, it should be eight fueling positions. To start with enough room to be able to grow. Challenge is the infrastructure, right? Can we get enough juice at that location to be able to support wherever we want? We want depots, you know, where you can come in and have as many locations. But we just got approved, or we're just about ready to close on a project in Orange, right on Marshall Road. It's a 4.5 acre site right at the off ramp. It took me 3 years to get, you know, approved for a Noble fueling facility, but we were approved for an EV showroom and service center. We're also approved in Newington for EV showroom service center next to a Noble facility, you know, with at least four DC fast chargers. The idea behind that is if somebody wants to come in and be ready to be able to, you know, sell or service, you know, EV cars, there's a couple of high visibility locations where they can come into next to a Noble station that has the ability to charge your vehicle. I don't want to go buy it in Somers, Connecticut, and not be able to charge my car, you know, other than be at home. So we're strategically looking at locations. So if you look at our sites, we're up and down 91, we're off of 84, we're off of 95 now, which are, it's great for the traveling public, but it's also great for the folks that live here, because they can come to a Noble station now and get a coffee breakfast offering, a sandwich or dinner offering, or ice cream after a ball game with the kids, and come in with indoor seating and outdoor seating, gives you something to do while you're charging your vehicle. But the experience needs to be, in my opinion, as close to it is to going to get, you know, get your gas car filled up, right? Come in 18 to 20 minutes, get your charge, you do your things, and you're on your way if you want. If not, you're there. But we're planning for the future on the initial rollout. So NEVI may only give us X amount. We're putting in the balance to get us to where we can support that demand.
I love that you keep bringing up high visibility, because I can't tell you how many times it's like, oh, I'm going to a Tesla supercharger. It's in the backside of a mall. It's like, they're ashamed of us charging. Anybody else have any questions?
Which one?
I pick one.
Thank you. I was curious if in one of your communities or your own projects, your client projects, has the topic of ADA compliance with charging stations come up, and how have you navigated that? So I found that there's a little bit murkiness between, you know, what's a requirement and what's really a recommended guideline. any information you could share would be helpful.
So I can tell you what my experience is. If you're applying for the federal money, then you need to comply with the ADA. I went round and round with them because the way we design our stations, if we can, is we have an EV canopy with a drive-through similar to what you have in a typical gas station convenience store. Every stall is ADA compliant, but they wanted a specific one that had to be set aside. And I'm like, well, I'm going to have four or eight fueling positions, and two of them nobody's going to use unless they're handicapped or, you know, accessibility, or somebody can use all of them. And then we went round and round about, you know, with the call buttons, right? If you need help, we have, you know, we have somebody that works at our facility to come out and help support that. And they're like, well, we don't need the call buttons. We just want to have a specific site or a specific space available for ADA compliance. I'm like, that doesn't make sense for me. I can understand that when you have a pull forward, right? And they need the space to get in and out of. But when you have the design that we have, it didn't make sense. And they said, it doesn't matter. They still want to have one ADA compliance. So I feel like we're losing two of the eight fueling positions if, you know, you pull up and you want to use it. So that's been my experience.
Yeah, as a developer, I'm running into a lot of different businesses. We would defer oftentimes to the property owner and say, well, what, given your use case and your business, what is required? The incentives oftentimes spell it out clearly, black and white, like this has to, you have to provide at least one space if you're going to do this many. So we make them aware of that information, but then it's really a balance of what their facility needs to do. The things that we might be able to help with is kind of queuing positions. What is this going to do to the traffic flow? Because a lot of folks who are investigating putting EV chargers in aren't EV drivers. EV chargers are not EV drivers. So they don't necessarily know about the culture of waiting in line or pulling, you know, nose in or backing in. Some cars can do one, some others can't. So we might be able to help them make conscientious decisions about their parking lot layout while also keeping a healthy distance from telling them how to, you know, run the traffic flow of the business.
Anybody else?
So two things with respect to Jeff's question and Stefan's response about the IRA. So there are maps that are published by the state. The IRA offers 30C incentives for rural communities and distressed communities. So there are maps available at the state. We published them on the EV Club website, so that they're not that hard to find, but unfortunately there's a pretty big section of the population that won't be covered by that. But I have a question for Stefan and Mike, which is about the lack of availability of juice in some locations, and have you done any exploration about storage or some other kind of grid edge solution? I think there's some incentives separately available for those. And if you are looking into storage, is battery load sufficient?
So to answer your question, yes, we've looked into all that. We have a project now in Windsor that we're looking at not only battery storage, but they call it off-site generation, but you put it on-site, so it's not a physical structure. But the size of the batteries would have to be so great for us to be able to get the juice that we need to charge multiple cars at the same time if we had a huge demand. And we're also looking at exploring how solar can, you know, can help get the batteries up to full charge and then be able to use those, especially in off-peak times, right? So if we have a set of DC fast chargers for the, you know, call it the morning and midday group, but we have level twos that can use the battery storage overnight, and we can have some sort of subscription model. We can better manage that, so we're looking through that. The challenge again is real estate. You know, you need enough real estate to be able to support. Is it one, you know, one battery that is the size of a, you know, a self-storage facility, you know, or is it several, right? And we also even explored going underground with that kind of thing and see if it would work to save real estate. So there's some drawbacks to that, but I also think that there's some opportunities there if we have big enough space to do it.
With hydrogen board?
That's one of the alternative sources we're talking about. You know, we have to call it off-site, so we're exploring that as well. And the challenge with that when you go into these municipalities is they don't know what that means, right? So you have to educate them. oh, you're going to have a hydrogen bomb on that property? You know, that's the challenge. So we bring in, you know, our experts to help try to explain that. But then you still, you know, the cost of that technology is really, really expensive too. But it can be done. We just need somebody to do it. We're hopeful that there will be one to be able to do it.
So we develop energy storage projects, both standalone or paired with solar, and that on it. There's a lot of use cases for energy storage. EV charging is just one of them. I think it gets a lot of attention because of the demand swings. Right? You plug in, you can go from 0 to 200 kW, you know, in a minute or so. So what the utilities have done is they've rolled out a purely volumetric rate option where the demand is irrelevant, right? So this transfers that challenge and responsibility to the grid. But financially speaking, for a business owner, it would make no sense to add the battery because there are administrative solutions to managing that charge. Now, those volumetric charges are set to be walked back over time. So it could be that 3, 4, 5 years down the road, you're back in a more conventional rate structure where the demand is there. And the data should also be available to say, well, how big of a battery do we need? What is the throughput? And I like to think of it as the toilet bowl, you know, model, right? It fills up slowly, somebody plugs in, it flushes, and charges again. And what it's doing is you're just shaving the peaks of that, going from, instead of going from 0 to 200, you're going from 0 to 50, and the battery's doing the other 150 for a period of time. And it's managed charging, but instead of focusing on getting all that to the battery, you're kind of preloading the managed charging in the battery on site. And when the battery is not being used to charge those cars, it can actually then be enlisted in the grid services and power a grocery store across the street or a hotel. And so there's a very, very robust plan for energy storage. But on-site EV is currently what I found to be unfortunately too specific. And I've seen some very good brands that try to roll this out with batteries integrated into chargers that have started and failed because they're just ahead of their time. But it is coming, and it's I think a natural solution.
I just would like to make a point from the municipal point of view that part of the advantages of electric school buses is that the energy that's stored in their batteries overnight can be used in times of crisis. So that's another really big advantage of having electric school buses.
I think I'm ready to close it.
Okay.
We're the only thing between them and lunch. So last week in Vancouver, though, you talked about kind of peak shaving, those peak charges that an operator like yourself can get hit with from the utility. They can be really expensive. In the Rocky Mountains of Canada there, they had a free wire station. That company recently kind of folding. But we had them present to EV Club 3 years ago, right? It's a charging station where they couldn't get a big enough transformer for the site. So they put in a battery at the charger, this giant machine, and that's where people plug in their EVs. So different solutions for different places, but like you said, you have to look ahead at what regulations might do to your business 2, 3, 4 years out as you make your selection of charging from now. Okay, well, with that, I'll close things out before lunch here and point out that our next one up is at 1 o'clock with Brandon Smith from EV Noir. Thank you.